This is a bank snap. It is made of coarse sand grains impregnated with a thin layer of silver fulminate explosive and twisted in cigarette paper. This is a bank snap explosion. And this is what the air around looks like when the explosion occurs. How is it possible to see it? Well, in today's video, we are diving into the world of Schlieren imaging, a fascinating method to visualize fluid flows that you normally cannot see. This is made possible by outlining the changes in the fluid's refractive index due to changes in air density or composition. I will explain in more details what it means, and I will show you a Schlieren test setup that is an optimized trade-off between cost and performance that you can easily reproduce if you want. It is easy to build, easy to tune, scalable, and fairly affordable. I will also show you along the way how to design such a setup using FreeCAD, an open source mechanical CAD software. But first, let's review the working principle. Refractive index is defined as the ratio of the apparent speed of light in vacuum to the speed of light in a medium. Within a medium with constant refractive index, light travels as a straight line. But when it encounters a media with a different refractive index, there is a change in direction. So, in a fluid with density gradients, for example, the light is bent in different directions depending on those gradients. The changes in the refractive index of air are really tiny, much smaller than the changes which happen between different types of materials, for example, the change between air and glass. Although the variations are really tiny, if you let the light travel long enough, it will be deflected enough to get a measurable effect. There are two main variants to do the measurements, which have their pros and cons: a single mirror setup and a Z-type setup, which uses two mirrors. I'll start by describing the Z-type version, although the setup I will be showing is a single mirror type. In a Z-type setup, the light entering the test region is composed of parallel beams of light. To be able to make a measurement, you need first to make an image of the test region. For that, you can use either a lens or a mirror. To make an image using a mirror, you need to use an off-axis parabolic mirror, as it is this type of mirror that enables you to converge parallel beams to the focal point of the mirror. The deflected light, which was not parallel to the mirror axis, on the other hand, will not converge to the focal point. To create the parallel beam of light for illuminating the test region, you can use another parabolic mirror. The point source is placed at the focal point. The test region is in the middle of the two mirrors, where the light beams are parallel. A single mirror setup is simpler. It uses a spherical mirror. Putting a point source at twice the focal length of the mirror, the light will reflect off the mirror back to the point source. If you place the source off-axis, you can get an image which do not overlap the source. However, as you do so, the image is not perfectly focused anymore. There are some aberrations which increase as you increase the off-axis position. But keeping the off-axis separation low, you can have low impact on measurements. Now, for both single and dual mirror Schlieren setups, outlining the deviated beams requires applying a special filter to the image. There are several ways to do this, one of which is using a knife edge. In a Z-type setup, the knife edge is placed at the focal point, while in a single mirror setup, it is positioned at twice the focal length. For simplicity, I will refer to this position as the focal point, but keep in mind that for single mirror setup, it actually corresponds to twice the focal length. By placing the knife edge at this focal point, you can modulate the light intensity at the sensor by partially blocking the undeflected light. This is known as the cutoff. At this position, the knife edge uniformly affects the undeflected light. You can easily verify this. If the knife edge is positioned in front of the focal point, half of the image will be darkened. If it is placed behind the focal point, the darkened side will be reversed. Only at the focal point is the light uniformly dimmed. Regarding the knife edge effect, Light deflected above the edge creates a brighter area on the sensor, while light deflected below the edge is blocked, producing a darker area. The higher the cutoff, the greater the sensitivity to deflected light, but at the cost of reducing the overall light reaching the sensor. Another way is to use a color filter. Using such a filter, you can highlight the beams which are deflected in different directions. In the case of a two-color filter, some light will go through one color and some will go through the other color. You can even make a more complicated filter with four colors. Now, the choice depends on what you are trying to visualize. Especially if you are looking to very fast-moving fluids, like a shockwave, you need to have fast capture with the sensor, so a low exposure time. Low exposure time means less light hitting the sensor on each recording. In this case, a monochrome camera is better suited, as they have higher sensitivities. Hence, the knife edge is better suited in this case. Color vision can also be interesting in some cases, at least for making nice looking images. But for metrology purposes of the Schlieren technique, the monochrome version is good. In the setup, I will be using a monochrome camera and a green diode as the point source. Then, for faster measurements, I will use a fast and powerful green laser diode. Now, one more thing about the placement of the knife edge. We've seen that it should be positioned at the focal point of the mirror. However, its orientation affects the image contrast, as the setup is sensitive to density gradients perpendicular to the knife edge. For example, with a vertical airflow from a candle, placing the knife edge vertically creates a high contrast image. However, if the knife edge is positioned horizontally, the airflow becomes nearly invisible. Additionally, the side on which the knife edge is placed determines the contrast direction. Placing it on the right or left reverses the bright and dark areas. For the light source, I am using a coaxial green LED designed for microscope. The LED's active area is quite large to provide uniform illumination for microscopy. It is not a true point source as it includes a lens that collimates the beam, making it parallel. However, in practice, the beam diverges enough to cover the mirror, making it suitable for this Schlieren setup. In contrast, a laser diode has a much smaller emitting area, making it more suitable as a point source. But it is more complex to set up. One advantage of a laser diode is its ability to generate fast and powerful light pulses, which can significantly improve image sharpness when capturing fast-moving events. When using a laser, the generated pulses must be synchronized with the camera. This can be done using the additional connector at the back of the camera, which provide I/O ports for control and triggering image captures. For comparison, this diagram shows that in normal operation, the LED remains on continuously and the camera runs in auto-trigger mode. If the sensor is already at its minimum exposure time, image sharpness cannot be improved further unless the light pulse is used to reduce the effective exposure time. With a laser, the light can be turned on only for a portion of the exposure, reducing motion blur. Even though the sensor continues recording when the laser is off, this is not an issue as long as there is no stray light reaching the sensor. And because the peak power of the pulse is higher, the power average over the exposure time stays the same. We can relate this timing diagram to the motion of fluid in the image, which I will refer to as particles for simplicity. Under LED illumination, a particle is recorded throughout the entire exposure time. If the particle moves very fast, it will appear blurred on a large area. With a laser, however, the image is sharper because, while the particle continues moving when the laser is off, that motion is not recorded. For example, using a 4 microsecond laser pulse is equivalent to capturing images at 250,000 frames per second. This technique can be a cost-effective alternative to high-end ultra-high-speed cameras, which are extremely expensive. While these specialized cameras can achieve very high frame rates, they do so at a significant reduction in resolution. In contrast, by using a laser pulse with a slower 4K camera, you can capture single-shot 4K images at a high equivalent frame rate and at a fraction of the cost. One last thing to review. In the case of a single mirror Schlieren setup, you have to consider the ghosting effect due to the beam crossing twice the test region. You can see this effect on this blurred image of a solder iron tip, and on the video of the bung snap explosion, you can see duplicated sound grains. This effect does not exist in dual mirror setup, but the trade-off is that it is more complex to set up and align two mirrors. Now let's go over the technical aspects of the design. First, the mirror's size should be large enough to cover your test region. There are various types of mirrors available, and here is a list of common options you can find on AliExpress at reasonable prices, along with their diameters and focal lengths. For this setup, I chose a 76mm mirror with a 700mm focal length. So, as we discussed earlier, in a single mirror setup, the light source and the image should be placed at 1.4 meter, twice the focal length. The camera is positioned behind the focal point, where the knife edge is placed. I am using a monochrome CS mount USB 3 camera from FLIR. It has a resolution of 1.5 megapixel at 227 frames per second, and it features a global shutter sensor. There are two types of camera sensor: global shutter and rolling shutter. A rolling shutter captures images line by line, while a global shutter captures all pixels simultaneously. For Schlieren imaging of fast-moving fluids, a global shutter is essential because it prevents the distortions that rolling shutter can cause. The sensor of this camera is an IMX723. Its diagonal is 6.3 mm and the pixel size is 3.45 micrometer, making the active sensor area about 5.05 mm horizontal by 3.75 mm vertical. The mirror size being 76 mm, if we want to fit the height of the mirror to the height of the sensor, which is 3.75 mm, we need to multiply the magnification M by the distance to the object to get the focal length needed for the lens. In this case, the focal length of the lens should be 69 mm. So, if we use a camera lens with this focal length, the resulting field of view should be about 102 mm by 76 mm. I bought a lens marked to have a variable focal length from 5 to 100 mm on AliExpress. However, after mounting it on the camera, it didn't seem that the marking was correct. It did not go to 100 mm as specified. So, to measure the effective focal length, I created a target grid in LibreOffice Impress. I printed the target and placed it at 1.4 meters of the camera. At maximum zoom, I have a field of view of about 100 by 75 mm. So, luckily, about the 69 mm focal length needed. It covers the height of the mirror, but I won't be able to zoom more. However, it is good for use with larger mirrors to measure larger test regions. Here are examples of the focal lengths and resulting field of views needed for different mirror sizes. Once the mirror size and focal lengths are selected and the camera and lens are matched to the mirror, it is then possible to focus on the mechanical aspects of the setup. A 1.4 meter setup is quite large and it requires precise positioning of all components to ensure proper alignment. The design was done in FreeCAD. For this setup, I chose to use 10mm aluminium profiles from MakerBeam that I already had, but using a larger profile could be a better choice. For example, using a single profile with a cross-section of 40mm by 80mm and a length of 1.6 meter. But the advantage with the current design is that it can be separated in half so that it can be easily moved and stored or reused for another project. Next, I used micrometer manual positioning stages to make easy, fast and precise tuning. The positioning stages were purchased from AliExpress and you may request the 3D step files from the vendor, making it really simple to integrate those parts. The XYZR stack determines the minimum height of the light source, so the mirror must be raised accordingly. Fortunately, we see that with this minimum required height, we will also be able to fit a mirror up to 203 mm diameter within the setup. The mirror support is 3D printed. With the source height set, the knife edge and camera must be raised to the same level. To achieve this, I used 3D printed stands for both the camera and the ZX stack, which allows for fine adjustment of the knife edge. Then the components need to be off-axis. A 1.2 degree offset was chosen. This could be reduced by using a 40 mm stack instead of a 60 mm stack, but this small angle should still be okay. Once all the parts are sourced and 3D parts are printed, it is time to assemble. That's about it for this video. Thank you for watching it. Schlieren imaging is a fascinating technique with applications in aerodynamics, fluid dynamics, and heat transfer visualization. Whether you are experimenting at home or using it for research, I hope this video has given you useful insights and inspiration for your own setup. If you enjoyed this content and want to see more, please consider subscribing, leaving a like and sharing it with your friends. It will definitely help me get started and bring more videos like this in the future. Thanks again and see you in the next one.